to that again. It's not a nice funny, fuzzy feel to it. So I've used the same colours again, but slightly stickier. For some of the closer bushes and so forth. The same colour again, that's a little bit of offering blue there. All the rooftops. It's beginning to stand out again now against the lighter background. A couple of windows. Must get the window in, there's one down here, where I would sit for hours looking at the ship boats outside.
How old were you at this time?
We used to hire yachts on the East Coast when I was 14, 15.
Right.
Yeah, quite young. And in fact, it was not long, it was about this time, but I think I probably told you, I ran away to sea. Yeah.
Well, what are those trousers on?
Yes. Yeah. We lived at Dovercourt, which is by Harwich, and all they wanted to do was go to sea. So one day, I made myself some, cheese and pickle sandwiches. Put them in a little bag and walked 2 miles from where we lived to down to Harwich, down to the halfpenny pier, which is still there. You don't have to pay a halfpenny now to go onto it. They went down there, it was lunchtime, waited till the men had all gone, and climbed down this ladder on the pier onto this boat and hid under a tarpaulin, waiting for it to go to sea. And I waited, and nobody came back. And eventually, you know, I ate the sandwiches and I was getting a bit hungry. So I thought, oh, I'll go for a game of sandwiches.
Sailor.
So I climbed back up the ladder again, got home. Of course, no things as children. You could go off for a whole day without parents worrying.
I bet they didn't even miss you.
No, no. My mother said, "Oh, your tea's coming up soon." And then she went back to me and she sniffed. "What's up to you?" "I don't know. Where have you been? You smell like a fishmonger." And of course, what I'd done was I had climbed down onto the deck and hidden under the tarpaulin. I was shrimper. Which only went out at 10 o'clock at night, came back at 5 o'clock in the morning. So nobody ever knew that I had actually done this. So there's a 10% embarrass going in. So it was a complete utter failure.
So are you still using the same colours?
Yes, just the two or three colours. The burnt umber, the offering blue, and a bit of violet. Okay, so that's... And I'm going to put this one in the foreground here now as well. This one's quite an interesting one. It's, as I say, I was asked, it was, the Americans are very, very... up their own rear ends at times, about especially about lock design, and they think that they're the best, etc. They are pretty good. But they came to an Englishman to redesign this thing, which was done by Rose and Crowninshield in the 1930s, very famous yacht design. And it's because they realised, when they read the history part of my website, Survey Official website, that I had been, not apprentice, but I was assistant to a lad called James McGurr. James McGurr, member of the British Olympic Committee and the America's Cup Committee, and we had a lot to do with the America's Cup Committee, 17, was apprenticed to a guy called Nathaniel Herreshoff. And Nathaniel Herreshoff is American, and thought of as being the granddaddy of yacht design. And so when they realised that, they sort of accepted me. So it was quite extraordinary for me to be working on what was an old and very famous American design, and upgrading it, new keel design, new rudder, everything else. So a little bit of feather. Right, okay. I'm just going to put in now one or two. Reflections. Reflections usually should be darker than the actual thing itself, so I'm going to put them slightly darker. And then I'm going to drop in a little bit of red with them as well. The guy in my book, Jim, who took on this girl, Sally Brackett, he sailed up the Thames in a yacht called, it was actually called the Coconut Lady. In the book I call it the Coconut Girl, which was a lovely, lovely boat. It stank of the South Pacific and the South Seas. So as youngsters at that time, 14, 15 years old, of course, we immediately started dreaming of palm-drenched beaches, girls wearing coconut shells, not a lot else, grass skirts. And so we just, it just enhanced our dreams.
You still have those dreams.
Yes, you get to an age, don't you? Who was it Bernard Shaw? It was such a relief when you got to an age where sex and women didn't matter anymore. It just didn't count. I haven't quite got there yet. But and of course you can't say that sort of thing in public, now.
You are.
No.
Big evidence here.
Because it's sunset, so you've got the
colours. It looks a bit dark.
Beautiful.
So, when you were sat in the window for hours on end looking at the boats, did you think you'd end up here in Lake Cock?
No. It's a sad story.
Where did you go wrong?
Well, no. Medical matters. I was known at school, I was known as Commander Fisher, because I was, only from the age of 8 or whatever, I was just so mad. My father was on the Russian Commonwealth, as everything else, and I'd inherited the photographs he had from Archangel and places like that, and the, when they tried to sink the Scharnhorst and what's that carrying. I was, you know, as I said, just absolutely mad keen on it, but unfortunately, he upstairs or whoever decided that that was not going to happen. So at the age of 14, I developed type 1 diabetes, which put a kibosh on that. I was told at the careers thing, well, the best we can do for you is we allow you to join the NAFI. Which,
didn't help the situation.
Yeah. Mind you, see, the thing is, I've had the most fantastic career. I mean, yacht design, boat design is just It's not well paid, though the bit I do isn't well paid. But it's so exciting early hours, it's great, I love it. And it's quite likely that if I had not had the diabetes, I would have ended up on a warship in 1982 in the Falklands, and I've probably got my bottom shot off. So actually, it's like anything else in life, isn't it? You're going to take it to the car. So I'm just putting in one or two little details for you. And with any painting, and then, you know, you've got both here, so that this is quite easy, because you've got glass, you can't get away from that. In any painting, if you get some lampposts in, or trees, or whatever else, anything vertical, then that's great, because verticals, in any scene, especially street scenes and so forth, they tie the bottom of the painting to the top. So they're good to have. So there you go, there's some of the detail work on the barge. We'll put in a mooring post and then so forth there. So that begins to come together now a little bit.
Is this going to be an exhibition at the weekend?
Yes, but not this one. Oh. I've done it before, but smaller. So the smaller version will show you. See how this one comes out. But the sailing took me from the East Coast to the Thames, which is where a lot of my book is based on, where we had all sorts of tales, learning about life and so forth. And then up to Newcastle and Scotland, West Coast, where I started out as a professional yacht designer and naval architect with two very, very famous companies. I'll come back to those in a minute. Where I spent most of my time just racing. Admiral's Cup and all sorts of so forth. Incredible experience. And now what I'll do is I'll put in one or two little reflections, get those going. We're almost, in many respects, we're almost there, to some extent. Reflection. I find that with reflections, with moss, we've got the spritz coming off here, the diagonal, and that should really go in, but I find if you do that too much, it's strange. Reflections are always better when they're vertical. This all dries out, which is why when the barges would sail up and then wait for the tide to go out, this other bottom, carts would come down with wheat and cement and God knows what else, and then wait for the tide to rise and they would sail off. But if you, like I did on silver fish, especially further around, there's a place called Tollsbury Creek, and the channel is marked by withies, and withies are basically branches of trees or so forth, rammed into the water, rammed into the... And if you don't catch the right withy at the right point and the tide's going out, you tend to end up lying on your side all night, which is not very comfortable. Right, so what I'll do now is tie that in over here. Put in some flats. When I say flats, I mean mud flats. And as we get closer to the eye, closer to the foreground here, I'll put a little bit more on them to darken them up, make them a bit richer. A bit more burnt umber, a bit more orange violet. And the nice thing about this paper is it's got quite a good tooth to it, which means it's quite rough. It means you can drag and brush over it and end up with a nice speckled effect. A little bit too much light there, so I'm going to cut that down a bit. This is where you start to look at your painting and just do a little reflection there. And just start rebalancing it, getting the arrangement correct. Some darker markings of rocks and so forth in the foreground.
Why do you paint so many sunsets, Paul?
I don't actually.
Do you?
No, I've done several over the last couple of months. I haven't done them for years.
It's your sunset period, is it?
This is my orange sunset period.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, almost there. I'm just going to dry it off very quickly. Flick it a few more dirty marks. Now, when you take off masking fluid, what you should do, and masking fluid, if you use it, don't leave it on overnight, because it really sticks to the paper, and when you try to take it off later on, it'll very often take the surface of the paper off too. What I should do is go to the loo and wash my hands. You should always work with clean hands when you're doing this. That's a little too stark. Spatter them up so good. Okay. If you don't clean your hands, then you find you put a pencil on, it'll just muddy up and dirty up and so forth. So some of those marks are just a little bit too much. That hasn't come out too well. Won't worry about that. A little bit of speckle down here, again a little bit too much. So what I'm going to do is just come into the foreground here. I want to retake the eye in, so I'm just going to put in some random smudgy marks. If you ever do sail on the East Coast, it's just mud, and it's poorly stuck if you get stuck to your boots. Of course, we're in the land here of the will-o'-the-wisp, where sailors, especially after a night on the booms, get led astray, not by barmaids, but by the wisp, which takes them further across the mud flats to their death and doom. Right, I could do more to that, but I won't. I think that's enough.
That's great.
Mm-hmm. And what I haven't done is I haven't brought in a mouse. If I bring in a mouse, it looks a lot better, actually. Okay. But washes, two different washes, one over the other. Can you see how blue wash, cobalt, are going over the yellow circles? You do get a slight green tinge, and that's, two transparent washes over each other. That's perfectly okay. But when you putting on two different washes like that, you're going to make sure that the first wash is bone dry before you put the second wash on. And it's a good idea, even though the blue on this was mainly on the side, I didn't take it across here, it's a good idea to put the water on right the way across. And that way you don't get hard edges with the second wash. And then the rest of it, just use complementary colours. So we've got blue and orange and red in the background and so forth. This brown and ultramarine blue and so forth is complementary to that. So it works, the two work very, very well together. And that's basically the only colours I use, apart from the washes. The final colour all around here and so forth was simply burnt umber, which is that lovely reddy brown, violet, and maybe a little bit of ultramarine blue here and there. And then just simple shapes. And you can see here we've got all the background stuff going on, just one or two flippy masts. Some of them aren't even attached to boats, it doesn't really matter too much. And you end up with quite a nice arrangement.
Mm, okay.
Nice. Good. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.